Good day, everyone. Welcome to lecture 9 of Theory of Computation. And in this particular lecture, we will be discussing about the deterministic finite automaton. So in one last lecture, we were discussing about the finite automata. And we said that this finite automata has two different types. One is the deterministic finite automata, and another is non-deterministic finite automata. And under this non-deterministic finite automata, there is another category that is epsilon non-deterministic finite automata. And in today's lecture, we will be discussing about the deterministic finite automata. Okay. So which is also called DFA. So first of all, you should know what is a finite automata. So finite automata is a five tuple entity. And what is that five tuple? Q. And then we have set of alphabet. We have the transition function. We have the initial state, and we have the set of final states. Okay, so this is the finite automata. And DFA, it is the simplest finite automata. Okay. Simplest finite automata. Okay, and for DFA, in the DFA, for every state, there is exactly one transition defined for each symbol, defined for each symbol in the alphabet set. And what is the alphabet set? It is sigma. So this portion, this is the deterministic feature of a DFA. Deterministic. What is the meaning of deterministic? Deterministic means that there is no ambiguity. No ambiguity means that in this kind of finite automata, if we have a state, on this particular state, if any symbol from this alphabet set comes, then for every symbol, there is how many transition is possible? One transition, not more than one. So there is no ambiguity on the input. So if we have an input, we have a deterministic transition from this state to any other state. So that is why it is called a deterministic finite automata. Why it is called a deterministic finite automata? Because there is no ambiguity in the transition. Ambiguity in the transition. And also for every symbol, there is how many transition is possible? Only one transition possible. Okay. You cannot have multiple transitions on the same symbol on the same state. Fine. And the other feature of the DFA is that every state remembers only a finite information. And what can be that finite information? And that particular finite information is the what state it is in. So every state remembers only finite information. And we know how many states are there. There are finite states. Okay, and every state remembers how much information, finite information. So overall, information that is stored by a DFA is finite. It cannot store an infinite information. So if we define this DFA formally, what it will be? DFA is a five-tuple entity. So the five-tuple is Q, sigma, transition function, Q0, and F. Where Q0 is initial state. Initial state. And F is the set of final states. Final states. And remember that this final state can be, this set can be empty as well. Empty means that there is no finite state. There is no final state in the DFA. So what is the difference from this particular definition, this formal definition of DFA, and this definition of finite automata? The difference is in the transition function. So what is the transition function? Transition function has input state Q and symbol alphabet, and the output is also some state in this set. For this finite automata, transition function may or may not be defined for every state, comma, symbol pair. Okay. So what does that mean? It means that in the finite automata, transition function is not defined, may or may not be defined for every state symbol pair. However, for the DFA, the transition function is defined for every state symbol pair. That means that on every state, whatever the symbols are, so how many symbols may be there? The number of symbols that are in this set, in this alphabet set. Let's suppose there are three symbols, A, B, and C. So that means there will be transition possible for state Q and A. There will be transition on this, and transition on this. So there is transition on every state and every symbol pair possible. And also, what will be the output of this transition? In the finite automata, this output can be a single state, multiple states, or no state. So single state means that if I have a state and I have some symbol, then I can go to only one output state. Okay. However, multiple states means that on a single state for a single symbol, let's suppose symbol is A. So on a single state, on a single symbol, there are multiple transitions possible. So there is this kind of transition and there is another transition like this. So on same symbol, we have how many outputs? Two output states. Okay, so we don't know whether we have to go here or we have to go here. And the third case is no state. No state means that for a state, if we have some symbol, any symbol, there is no transition defined on that particular symbol. Okay, so finite automata, in the finite automata, this output of a transition function may be a single state, multiple states, or no state. However, in case of a DFA, this output can be only one state. Okay, so let me reiterate these things here. Let me rub these things first. So what I have to make you understand it, what is the difference between a finite automata and a DFA. So let's first write a finite automata. What is a finite automata? Finite automata is this tuple. Transition function, initial state and final state. Okay. Now, let's discuss this transition function, this sigma. So it takes this, it is this particular function. So what does that mean? Input to this transition function is a pair. Which pair? A pair of state and symbol. Okay. And what is the output? Output. The output can be a single state. Okay. It can be multiple states. Or it can be no state. What does that mean, no state? No state means there is no transition defined on some state and some symbol. Let me give an example. For example, this is, let's say alpha bit is 0, 1. Okay. Let's say this is the DFA. This is the finite automata. So in this finite automata, okay, so what is Q? Q is Q0, Q1, Q2. Okay, what is sigma? Sigma is 0, 1. What is Q0? Q0 is Q0. Initial state is Q0. Final is empty. Now what is transition? Transition function. So transition function here is defined for, so what are the possible transitions? So possible transitions are Q0, 0, this is 1. Another is Q0, 1. Another is Q1, 0. Another is Q1, 1. Another is Q2, 0. Another is Q2, 1. So these are the possible transitions. So can there be any other transition? No. So these are the possible transitions. Okay. So is this transition defined in this particular automata? Yes. On Q0, when 0 comes, where can we go? So the output is either Q1 or Q2. So is this transition defined? Delta Q01, on Q0, do we have defined this? No. So is no state. Output is no state. No state means this transition is not defined. Now Q10, on Q1, if we have 0, is it defined? No, it is also not defined. Q11, it is also not defined. Q20, it is also not defined. And Q21, so for Q21, we have. So you can see that input is the pair state and symbol, and output can be a single state. For example, output can be a single state. It can be multiple states. For example, the multiple states here, and it can be no state. No state means that transition is not defined. So this is for finite automata. Now in DFA, DFA is like a finite automata, is a finite automata. And what is the difference? The difference is that this transition function, so delta, is defined for all the pairs. So here you can see this transition function is not defined for these pairs. So can this be a DFA? No, it cannot be a DFA. So this is the first thing. Second thing is, output of transition function can be only a single state. A single state. So here you can see that output is two states. So this particular automata is violating all these two conditions, condition one and condition two. So this cannot be a DFA. This is a finite automata, but this is a different type of finite automata. This is not a DFA. So let me give the example of a DFA. Okay. Let me rub this portion here. Okay. Let me make a new automata here. So let me rub this portion. Okay. Let me make a DFA. Let's say this is. Let's say sigma is A comma B. Okay, so let's take this particular DFA. Okay, so what is the states here? What is the set of states? Q0, Q1, comma Q2. Fine. Now, okay, so this is Q. And what is the final state here? Final state is Q2. Okay, what is the initial state? Initial state is Q0. And now let's discuss about the transition functions. So what are the possible transition functions? First, let's see what is the possible transition function. This is one. This is another. Another one is Q1 comma A. Another transition function is Q1 comma B. Another transition is Q2 comma A. Another transition is Q2 comma B. Okay, so let's see whether they are defined and what is the output. So on this Q0 comma A, we have Q1. On Q0 comma B, we have Q0. So on Q1 comma A, we have Q2. On Q1 comma B, we have Q1. On Q2 comma A, we have Q2. On Q2 comma B, we have Q2. Now let's see the definition. So DFA. So this transition function should be defined for all pairs. So you can see that it is defined for all the pairs. So these were the pairs and it is defined for all. Defined for all means that output is there. And second, so first condition is verified. Now comes the second. Output of transition function can be only a single state. So you can see output is how many states? Only one state. So the second condition is also verified. So this particular is a finite automata. But what kind of finite automata? Deterministic finite automata. Okay. So this is how a deterministic finite automata differentiates from a general finite automata. Okay. Now let's write some of the examples. Let's make some of the problems, and then let's see how we can design DFA for those particular problems. So let me rub this portion here. So let's say we have to design a DFA that accepts the following language, or we can say that recognizes the following language. So let's take the first one. L is equal to W. W belongs to 0 comma 1 star, such that W has at least one. So what does that mean? So I am writing this language. What is the language? Language is the set of strings. Okay. So it is saying that this language contains strings. So here it is saying W belongs to 0 comma 1 star. What does that mean? 0 comma 1 star means sigma star. Okay. What is sigma star? Sigma star is the set of all strings that can be made using 0 and 1. We have already discussed that. So W is a string, but this string has at least one. So will this particular string a part of this language? Yes. Why? Because it contains one. Will this string a part of this language? Yes. This will also be a part of this language. Will this string a part of this language? No. Why? Because this string does not contain any one. Okay. So we have to make a DFA that recognizes this particular language. What does that mean? I have to design a DFA such that it accepts only those strings that have at least one and rejects all those strings that have no one. Okay. So how I can make an automata? So I have to only remember two things here. Okay. First thing, my state should remember whether it has seen a one. Okay, this information it has to remember whether it has seen a one. So there are only two possibilities. Possibility is yes, it has seen a one, and another possibility is no. No means it has not seen a one. Okay, so initially let's make a state. So let's keep this Q0. Let's say Q0 is a state that says I have not seen one. Okay. So initially, what will be the state? Q0. Why? Because initially that means it has not seen any one. So this will be the initial state. Now on this state, what are the possible values? Possible symbols is 0 and 1. So on this Q0, there are two possible symbols, 0 and 1. Because in a DFA, we have to see what will be the possible transition for every symbol. So let's see first for the 0. So if 0 comes, whether there will be any change in the state? Because state here means whether it has seen 0 or not, whether it has seen 1 or not. So it will remain in the same state. If it has seen which symbol? Zero symbol means Q0. Q0 means I have not seen one. However, if one comes means its state will change. Now we have to go a new state, Q1. Q1 means I have seen one. So it will go to a new state, Q1. And we know that we want to create a language, or we have to create a DFA that will recognize those languages or those strings where we have at least one. So if we are in state Q1, so that means I have seen at least one. At least one. Then only I would have moved from state Q0 to Q1. So this state Q1 will be our final state. So on Q0, we have seen both the symbols 0 and 1. Now we have to see the same on Q1. Because for every state in a DFA, for every state, we have to see the transition for every symbol. So on Q1, what are the possible symbols? Possible symbols are again 0 and 1. Now if 0 comes, whether there will be any change in this particular state? Because Q1 means I have seen one. Now if 0 comes, whether there will be any change? No, there won't be any change because I have seen 0. Now if more zeros come or more ones come, it won't change my state. I will still answer that I have seen one. So whether 0 comes, it will remain in this state Q1. And on one also, it will remain in this particular state. So this will be the DFA. This particular will be the DFA for this particular language. Okay, so this is the DFA. So this portion. And this is the DFA for this particular language. So let's check. Let's take these symbol, this string. So should this DFA accept this string? No. Why? Because there is no one. So let's give it. So first is 0. So let's start from here. from the left to right. Always move from left to right. First is zero. So initially we are in Q0. Zero means we will stay in Q0. Second is zero. Again, we will stay in Q0. Third is zero. Again, we will stay in Q0. So that means what will be this Q0? It will give us Q0. So this is the extended transition function. So after consuming this particular string, what is the final state? Q0. Is this state final or non-final? It is non-final state. So that means this string is rejected. Okay. Now let's take another string, this particular. So if you see, after giving this string as input to this particular DFA, this DFA, output will be Q1. Q1 means final state. So that means this string will be accepted. So this is the DFA for this particular language. Now let's take another example. So let's say we have to design an DFA such that it recognizes the following language. L is equal to W belongs to 0, 1 star. That means W is a string such that W has even number of ones. So that means I have to design a DFA such that it accepts only those strings where the number of ones is even. So how many states are required? So for example, we will require following two states, or we can say we have to remember only two information. First information is number of ones seen is even. Another information is second, number of ones seen is odd. Okay. Let's say this information is stored in state Q0 and this information is stored in state Q1. Okay, fine. Now let's make a DFA. So what will be the initial state? Initial state means I have not seen anything. Anything means that number of ones is even. So initial state is Q0. Because Q0 means number of ones is even. And this will also be a final state. Because final state, or we can say an accepting state. Because this state, I have to design a DFA and the final state should be that state that is storing the following information. W has even number of ones. So Q0 will be our initial state and final state. Okay. Now on this Q0, we have to check what will be, whether there will be a change of state or we will remain in the same state if we see the following symbols. 0 and 1. Let's say 0 comes. If 0 comes, whether the number of ones change? No, there won't be any change in number of ones. So if the number of ones is even, it will remain even. Okay, so we will remain in this state. However, if 1 comes, so if I am in state Q0, Q0 means I have seen which one is even one is. Now another one comes, it will make the number of ones odd. So I have to move to a next state. And which is that state? That state is Q1. So that means I will go to a next state. That state is Q1. Because Q1 means that number of ones seen is odd. Okay. So this is on 1. Now if I am in Q1, if 0 comes, whether it will change the state? No, it will remain there. Now if 1 comes, 1 means that I am currently in which state? Q1 state. Q1 state means I have seen ones and those ones are odd. Now if another 1 comes, it will make number of ones even. So that means I will go to this state on 1. Okay. So is there any other possible transition or any other possible state? No, these are the only two states, and all transitions are defined on all symbols. So this will be a DFA that will only accept those strings where the number of ones is odd. So let's take this. So if you give this string as input to this, so star Q0, 01110, output will be Q0. Sorry, output will be Q1. Okay. Q1 means which state? Non-final state. So that means it will reject this string. Now, if it is like this. Okay. So if you give this string as input to this particular DFA, it should accept it. So if you give it, the output will be Q0, and Q0 is a final state. Final state means accepting. So this particular DFA will recognize this particular language, or we can say it will accept all the strings that are in this language, and it will reject all the other strings. Now let me write another example that will help us to understand the third example. Okay, then I will give some of the examples that you have to do on your own. So L is equal to W belongs to 0, 1 star such that W has 0, 1, 0 as a substring. So that means I have to design a DFA such that that particular DFA should accept those strings that have 0, 1, 0 as a substring. Let's take some examples. For example, should that DFA accept this particular string? Yes, it should accept because it contains 0, 1, 0. Should it accept this? Yes, it should accept because it also contains 0, 1, 0. Now let's take another string, for example, this particular string. So does this string belong to this language? No. Why? Because it does not contain 0, 1, 0 as a substring. So we have to design a DFA for this particular language. So let me rub these things. So if you can see, so what will be the possible states? The possible state will be, for example, state one. Let's see. State one means I have seen nothing. I have seen nothing. Okay. State two means, so this will be our initial state, Q0. State two means I have seen 0. So we will make the states based on this particular substring 0, 1, 0. Okay. So 0 is the first symbol. So let's say state 2 means I have seen 0. State 3 means I have seen 0 and 1. 0, 1. And state 4 means I have seen 0, 1, 0. Okay. And please remember state one, we can say I have seen nothing, or we can say I have seen one. One means one, because one is also of no use here in this particular language. This one alone, one has no use. Okay. So now let me make a DFA Q0. Initial, so let's say it is Q1, it is Q2, and it is Q3. So if I have seen 0, 1, 0, so that will be an accepting state. Okay. Q0, that is the initial state. So if on this Q0 we have 1, it will remain in this state because 1 has no effect. Now, if 0 comes, 0 means that I have seen 0. So I will go to a new state, Q1. Okay. Now, if on Q1, 0 comes, Okay, zero comes, it means in Q1, Q1 means I have seen zero. Now if another zero comes, so zero, zero, does zero, zero has any significance here? No, okay. Zero, zero also means that I have seen zero. Okay, so it will remain in this state. Now we have, let's suppose one comes. So I am in state Q1. Q1 means I have seen zero. Now one comes. One comes means I have seen zero and one. So which is that state? Q2 state. So that means I will move to Q2 state. Now on Q2. So I am in Q2 state. Q2 state means I have seen zero, one. Now on Q2, if zero comes, what does that mean? Zero comes, it means I have seen zero, one, zero. So that means I will go to state, which state? Q3 state. And Q3 state is our final state. Okay, so if zero comes. Now I am in state Q2, zero, one. Now if one comes means I have seen zero, one, one. And zero, one, one has no significance. No significance means I will go to here. Because it means I have seen nothing or I have seen a string that has no significance. Now let's suppose, so Q2 is completed. Okay, now let's go to Q3. So let's say I am in Q3. Okay, Q3 means I have seen 0, 1, 0. Now if 0 comes, will there be any change in the state? Because 0, 1, 0, 0, it does not change this particular, we can say this particular idea or this particular concept that I have seen 0, 1, 0. It will still remain there. Because 0 will not change this particular fact that I have seen 0, 1, 0. Or if 1 comes, that will also not change this fact. So whether 0 comes or 1 comes, I will remain in this particular state. So now you can see this is our complete DFA for this particular language. For which language? The language that accepts only those strings that has 0, 1, 0 as a substring. So this is the DFA that is recognizing this particular language. So these were the three examples where we have designed a DFA for different languages. Now let me write some more languages, but you should define the DFAs on your own by practicing as a homework. Okay, so let me write some of the DFAs and let me rub this portion here. And the DFAs that I will be, or we can say the languages that I will be providing here, you have to make DFA for those particular languages. Okay, let me rub this section first. So let me write some of the questions that you have to design a DFA. So let's take the first one. Okay, L is equal to W belongs to A comma B star such that the number of B's in W is congruent to 2 modulo 3 to 2 modulo 3. What does that mean? It means that if the number of B's in W is congruent to 2 modulo 3. So what is 2 modulo 3? 2 mod of 3. What is the answer? The answer is 2. Because 2 modulo 3 means 2 mod of 3. So what will be the remainder if 2 is divided by 3? The remainder will be 2. Okay, so it is saying that W is a string and the number of B's in this string. So let's say it is a string. So how many B's are there? 4. So 4 modulo 3, what will be that? It will be 1. Okay. However, if the number of B's modulo 3 is same as this, what is this? 2 modulo 3, 2. Then only those strings will be accepted. For example, this string won't be accepted. However, if I have a string like this, what is this? What will be the 2 modulo 3 here? So number of B's, what are the number of B's? 1, 2, 3, 4. Or let me write another 5. So what is 5 modulo 3? 5 modulo 3 is 2. So this is same as 2 modulo 3. So this string will be accepted. However, this string won't be accepted. Whether this string, what about this? So it is 1 modulo 3. What is 1 modulo 3? 1. So it is not same as 2 modulo 3. So this string won't be accepted. So you have to design a DFA such that only these type of strings are accepted and all other strings are rejected. So this is question number 1. Let me write another question. So let me rub this portion here. The question number 2 is, second question is, L is equal to W belongs to 0 comma 1 star such that W has even number of 1s and odd number of zeros. Even number of 1s and odd number of zeros. Third, L is equal to W belongs to AB star such that W contains AA as a substring. Okay. Fourth, L is equal to W belongs to A comma B star such that W has no 2 consecutive 1s. Okay. Fifth is, L is equal to W belongs to 0 comma 1 comma 2 star such that sum of digits in W is congruent to 1 modulo 3. Okay. Sixth is, L is equal to W belongs to 0 comma 1 star such that W has W starts with substring AA. So these are some of the examples, and for these particular languages, you have to design a DFA. So this is your homework, and you have to do this homework. Okay. So you have to design DFA for all these 6 problems, or we can say for all these 6 languages. Fine. So let me wrap this portion and we will start further. So now let's consider this. What is the language accepted by DFA? So if we have a DFA, this is our DFA M, then the language accepted by M will contain all strings that take M from initial to one of the final states. One of the final states. or I can write is as language of a finite automata is W such that language of a finite automata is W belongs to sigma star such that when we give this W as input to a DFA, it takes to a state QF such that QF belongs to the set of final states. So that means when we are giving this string as input to this DFA from the initial state, it will reach to one of the final states. So the set of all those strings will be the language of a DFA. Now we know finite automata, okay? And the language of a finite automata is called a regular language. Regular language. And we know that DFA is also a finite automata, one of the finite automata. So the language accepted by a DFA is a regular language. So if somebody says you, what is a regular language? So we know on the top level, we have regular language is a language for which there exists a finite automata, or we can say regular language is a language such that there exists a DFA that recognizes that language. So if anywhere in this particular course, I am saying L is a regular language, what does that mean? It means that there is a DFA M such that this M recognizes L. Recognizes M. Or vice versa. Vice versa means if there is a DFA, then the language accepted by this DFA is a regular language. Okay. So let me rub this here. Fine. So what is a regular language? A language for which there exists a deterministic finite automata. Okay. Now we have already discussed in our previous lecture, I think in lecture number 6, 7, or 8, some of the operations on languages. Operations on languages. Okay. So what were the different operations? The first operation was complement. The second operation was union of languages. Third operation was intersection of languages. Okay. Fourth operation was set difference. Okay. Fifth operation was concatenation. And sixth operation was star operation. Okay. So this was the operation on languages. Since our regular language is also a language, so that means these operations are also valid on regular languages. Okay. So let's discuss these operations on regular languages. So let's say, so basically we have to discuss the closure property of regular languages. What does that mean? Closure property means that if I am doing some operation on a language, okay, these particular operations. If I am doing these particular operations on a regular language, in the output, I will get some other language, okay? What is the feature of that language? Whether that language is a regular language or not a regular language. That comes under the closure properties of regular language. So let's first discuss about the complementation. What does that mean? Complementation means, so let's say L is a language, is a regular language. Okay, then L complement, what will be L complement? L complement will be all strings that are not in L. So we can write L complement is equal to sigma star. Sigma star means all strings minus strings of L. Okay, so if I write it in terms of the Venn diagram, it will be, let's say this is sigma star. Sigma star means all strings. So if this is L, then this particular portion, the portion outside here, this portion, this is L complement. Okay. Now closure property says if L is a regular language, then L complement is also a regular language. Okay, so that means regular languages are closed under complementation. What does that mean? When we are saying that regular languages are closed under complementation, what does that mean? It means that if L is a regular language, then it is complement is also a regular language. So here we have written that statement. But we should not rely on statements. We have to prove this statement as well. It is true. We know this is true, but we have to prove it. Because without proving anything, we cannot take that statement as a proof. So this is true, but we will prove it. Okay, this is a theorem and we will prove this particular theorem. So what is the theorem? So regular languages are closed under complementation. What does that mean? If L is a regular language, what does that mean if L is a regular language? If L is a regular language, it means that there exists a DFAM that recognizes L. Okay. Then L dash is also a regular language. That means there will exist another DFAM dash, such that M dash recognizes L complement. Okay. So we have to prove this particular statement, and how we are going to prove this particular statement? So we will prove it by using our that concept. If P, then Q. So that means if we have to prove this kind of statement, we will assume P is true, then we will prove Q. Okay. So here also first thing is that we will assume this thing. So we will assume that L is a regular language. Then we will prove that L dash is also a regular language. So let me prove this particular statement. Let me rub this portion from here, and I will prove this particular statement. So the first thing was about the complementation. So as I said, the regular languages are closed under complementation. What does that mean? It means that if L is a regular language, then L complement is also a regular language. Okay. So, but we have to prove this particular statement, and I will be proving this particular statement in our next lecture. That is lecture number 10. The second is union. Regular languages are closed under union. What does that mean? It means that if I have two languages, L1 and L2, and both languages are regular, okay? So these are regular languages, L1 and L2. Then their union, L1 union L2. So L1 union L2 will also be a language. Then this is also regular language. Okay, so regular languages are closed under union. This thing also we will prove in our next lecture. The third is intersection. And for intersection as well, regular languages are closed under intersection. Under intersection. And what does that mean? As it implies in point two, or we can say in theorem two, that if L1 and L2 are regular languages, then their intersection, what is the intersection? L1 intersection L2, that is also regular language. And we have to prove this statement as well. The fourth is the concatenation. Regular languages are closed under concatenation as well. What does that mean? If L1 and L2 are regular languages, then their concatenation means L1.L2. And we have already discussed what does this concatenation mean. Concatenation means that we will take the string of L1 and we will combine it with the string of L2. And we will do that with all possible combinations of L1 and L2. And this particular language will also be a regular language. Okay. Fifth, regular languages are closed under set difference. What does that mean? It means that if L1 and L2 are regular languages, then their difference, that is L1 minus L2, this is also a regular language. And the last one, that is the star operation. Okay, what is the meaning of star? Star means L1 0. For example, if L is a regular language, then what will be L star? L star means L0 union L1 union L2 dash 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 union L raised power N. What will be L2? L2 means L concatenation L. L3 means L concatenation L. So we have already discussed what is a concatenation in our previous lecture. So regular languages are closed under star operation as well. What does that mean? If L is a regular language, then L star is also a regular language. So these are the six operations. We have some more operations also, but we will discuss those particular operations when those particular operations are required in our lectures. But here, these are the six basic operations. Apart from these six, we have many more operations, but let's here stick to these six operations. So regular languages are closed under complementation, under union, under intersection, under concatenation, under set difference, and under star operation. Okay. So here I am saying that they are closed under these operations, but we have to prove these particular statements mathematically. And we will prove these statements in our lecture number 10. Okay. So I will stop this particular lecture here. And in our next lecture, we will start the same discussion again. But there in that discussion, we will mathematically prove each statement, why regular languages are closed under complementation, union, intersection, concatenation, set difference, and star. Okay. So let's stop this particular video here and the discussion about the deterministic finite automatas. And in our lecture number 10, we will prove these particular statements and we will also discuss some more stuff related to deterministic finite automatas. So let's meet in the next lecture. Till then, goodbye.